Oh. Oh. Maybe because of this, it would be better if you didn't go. You know, maybe because of this, for that one, you know, I think what you should do is get rid of this because it's so false what they're saying. It's such bullshit. I think this goes away quickly. I think it's probably better. Do the Charleston thing. Just this time. In 2 weeks it's fine. I think right now it's better. You know? Okay, honey. You take care of yourself. Thanks, Pam. Yep, I'm proud of you. So long. Bye. What's up, Mike?
Great poll, by the way. Yeah. Seeing it. Great poll.
Making progress.
Big time.
And you guys are good guys.
Oh, Pastor Scott?
I can't believe this. No. Pastor Scott, what's happening?
Oh, no. He's,
can we use him anymore?
Oh, yeah. No, you're talking about Mark Burns. We told him to...
Well, I don't mean that. Mark Burns, can we use him anymore?
No.
Richard Lefrak, I'm sorry. Richard Lefrak just called. He just had me have a chance. He had an idea for you.
Okay. So we got served from the New York Times. I told you this. We were regarding to unseal the divorce papers with Ivana. We're fighting it. Kasowitz is going to...
You should never be able to get that.
Never. Kasowitz doesn't think they'll ever be able. They don't have a...
Give me a cup, please.
They don't have a legitimate purpose.
And you
so,
have a woman that doesn't want to unseal.
Correct.
So you've been handling it.
Yes, and it's all...
It's been going on for a while.
For about 2-3 weeks now.
All you have to do is delay it for...
Even after that, it's not going to ever be opened. There's no purpose for it. Told you about Charleston. I need to open up a company for the transfer of all of that info regarding our friend David. You know, that I'm going to do that right away. I've actually come up and spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with.
So what are we going to
funding? That, yes, and it's all the stuff. All the stuff because you know you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be.
Gets it, but
correct. So I'm all over that, and I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be.
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to. Pay you so
No.
How are you?
All right, now a couple of things. There are side conversations. I wanted you to hear everything that was on the recorded that was provided to us. Those side conversations aren't relevant in my estimation, and I'm not including a translation of the tape because there is clearly a dispute about what is being said. So you have to listen, and I want to now play for you the portion that seems to matter the most. This is 2016, before the election. Donald Trump and Michael Cohen on recordings seized by the FBI, the specific conversation about the arrangements surrounding a payment that had been made to a former Playboy playmate. Here's that portion.
What's up, Mike?
Great poll, by the way.
Yeah.
Seen it. Great poll.
Making progress.
Big time.
And you guys are good guys.
Hello, Pastor Scott?
I can't believe this. No. Pastor Scott, what's happening?
Oh, no.
Can we use him anymore?
Oh, yeah. You're talking about Mark Burns. We've told him to...
I don't mean that. Mark Burns, can we use him anymore?
No.
Richard Lefrak, I'm sorry. Richard Lefrak just called. He just had me have a chance. He had an idea for you.
Okay. So we got served from the New York Times. I told you this. We were regarding to unseal the divorce papers with Ivana. We're fighting it. Kasowitz is going to...
You should never be able to get that done.
Never. Kasowitz doesn't think they'll ever be able. They don't have a...
Give me a cup, please.
They don't have a legitimate purpose.
And you
so,
have a woman that doesn't want to see him.
Correct.
So you've been handling it.
Yes, and it's all...
It's been going on for a while.
For about 2-3 weeks now.
All you have to do is delay it for...
Even after that, it's not going to ever be opened. There's no purpose for it. Told you about Charleston. I need to open up a company for the transfer of all of that info regarding our friend David, you know, that I'm going to do that right away. I've actually come up and spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with
so what are we going to
funding. That, yes, and it's all the stuff. All the stuff, because you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be.
Gets it, but
correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay for cash.
No. I got... No.
All right, so Trump's attorney, Rudy Giuliani, is aware we have the recording. Now, you'll remember the president waived his attorney-client privilege that allowed this tape to be released to prosecutors. Now, the team says they didn't leak the tape. This recording comes from Cohen counsel Lanny Davis, who we're going to talk to in a moment. But the point is, Giuliani says the privilege was waived because he and his team believe this tape is of no concern to Trump. In fact, they argue it helps him. Rudy Giuliani and the whole team were, of course, invited on the show tonight. In lieu of an appearance, their understanding of what is and is not said on the recording and the relevance of the same has been relayed to me. And I will make those points to Lanny Davis in our interview. However, at the onset, it seems there's one part of this conversation that matters most to both sides, and they disagree about what is said and what it means. It involves the discussion of how this corporation that was being set up supposedly to buy back any potentially damaging stories about Trump would pay for any such properties. Here's that section again.
And I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with
so what are we gonna pay?
Funding. That, yes. And it's all the stuff. All the stuff, because you know you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that, and I spoke to Alan about it. When it comes time for the financing, which will be
listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
No.
I got no.
All right, Lanny Davis is counsel to Michael Cohen, and he joins us now. Counselor, thank you for joining us. You provided this recorded. Why?
Because everybody heard just now Donald Trump say the word cash, after Michael Cohen mentioned financing, when Mr. Giuliani and Mr. Trump, through Mr. Giuliani, accused my client, Mr. Cohen, of saying the word cash. And I posted a tweet at the time, and I said, wait for the tapes. Richard Nixon couldn't spin the tape that did him in, and there's no way that Mr. Giuliani, who knows from being U.S. attorney, the only people who use cash are drug dealers and mobsters. Cash is not what you do. And it was Michael Cohen who said, no. And Donald Trump, despite what Rudy Giuliani said publicly, the tape contradicts Mr. Giuliani, and the word cash is heard by everyone.
Now, the president's legal team disputes what is being said in this tape. They even provided us their own transcript, which we'll put up at some point. They say that the president said, do not pay with cash, check, and that he was advising Cohen to do it all on the up and up because the president wanted to make sure that this was papered properly.
I'm looking at Mr. and Mrs. Donald Trump, Red America. Listen to the tape. It doesn't say what you just heard. It says cash. And it's Mr. Cohen who says, no. Now, don't believe me. I'm a Democrat. I'm a lawyer representing a client. Believe your own ears. And when Richard Nixon had a tape that he couldn't dispute, the tape says what it says. And I put a tweet out and said, listen to the tapes. So everyone out there, listen to the tapes. Whatever spin Mr. Giuliani is trying to invent, it says cash, and Michael Cohen says no.
It says some things before it. And in fairness, I didn't have this sweetened, which is what we call in this business, where a forensic expert goes through and pulls out pieces of sound. There's so much science around that now. We didn't have time to do that. So I want to go through both sides and the implications for both sides, but we don't want to get too far away from the big questions here. This recording could be argued to be fruit of the poisonous tree, that as counsel, Michael Cohen shouldn't have been recording his counsel, his client, then Donald J. Trump, now President Trump. How do you get past that, that this whole thing can't look good for Cohen because he should have never done it?
Well, I'm not going to shift the topic. It's up to Mr. Cohen to explain why he was taping Mr. Trump. He assumed it was an attorney-client privilege conversation. I'm going to let him speak to that. I have attorney-client privilege that I can't waive. But I will say this. There is no way to spin the two falsehoods that Mr. Giuliani, on behalf of his client Donald Trump, told America to disparage my client. One is that this is the first time that he heard about the Karen McDougal issue. Listen to the tape, everyone. This is not a man shocked when Mr. Cohen says we have to make payments.
Even though Michael is describing to him the formation of the company and why it's being formed and how it will be financed, you believe that's a second reference?
Listen to the tapes. This is not a man shocked about Karen McDougal. He knows what they're talking about. Listen to this tapes. They speak for themselves. Remember that Karen Hicks, the campaign spokesman, denied...
Hope Hicks, denied
that he knew anything about the McDougal matter in November before the election, a lie. And here, Mr. Trump is not surprised when Mr. Cohen mentions there needs to be financing, and he immediately says, cash. He doesn't say what the transcript that you're telling me says. He says cash. And my client has been disparaged over and over again by Mr. Giuliani with misinformation and misstatements. For example, what we have heard over and over again is that Mr. Cohen is living lavishly, and no mention is made that there was a tremendous flood in his apartment. He's living in a hotel with insurance paying for his hotel room. 14 times on the dossier, his name is mentioned and publicly posted were absolute rebuttals, false that he was ever in Prague. There's been a campaign out of the White House to disparage Mr. Cohen. And why is that, Chris? Because he's got truth on his side now, and he intends to tell the truth.
All right, fine. All of that be as it may, that is extraneous to what we're talking about with this tape and what is said on the tape and what is meant. Giuliani argues, and again, I have to represent his arguments because that's in the interest of fairness.
He's not here tonight.
He had the opportunity to come on. Maybe he'll take
maybe
it
next
later.
Time the mayor will confront me directly and say, what you hear with your ears, don't believe your ears, believe me.
Well, he says it's a lousy recording.
Lousy recording. Ear is what I would say.
And that it may have been done because it's very clipped at the end. You hear check and then it's gone and there's a new recording.
But that isn't the issue. The word is, who said the word cash? Giuliani said.
But in what context, Lanny?
But not context. I'm talking about the word. He said Cohen used the word cash. The tape has Trump using the word cash. Giuliani said something false on behalf of a client who is accustomed constantly to lying, and this is just another example.
I saw it reported by NBC that Giuliani had suggested that it was Cohen who wanted to pay cash. However, in his own statements, which we can put up for you there, we have pulled a couple of them. This is the transcript of what Team Trump says is said on the tape. Don't pay with cash. Check. You can decide for yourself when you listen to this. With one eye,
that's
though.
That's comical. That's not what the tape says.
I get what your argument is.
Mr. and Mrs. Trump America, listen to the tape. I know you don't believe fake news. Don't believe fake transcripts. The tape says what it says. Nothing that Giuliani or President Trump can do can alter what's on the tape. I leave it to you.
And so let's do that. Here it is again, the relevant
listen.
Section.
And I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with funding. And it's all the stuff. Because, you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay with cash.
No. No.
We'll pay with cash.
Right, but I don't know that
cash.
He's... But there are words that are muddled before it. And how do you know that if they have a forensic specialist, they don't tease something else out? The best question for you is this, on this point, because you can't answer that point. This is the best recording you've heard. Your client, was it his understanding in that moment that his client was telling him, be careful, don't pay with cash, suggesting pay with cash?
He heard the words. He said, no. What he said, no to, everybody, listen to the tape. What is this about? This is about honesty versus false disparagement of Michael Cohen. Why is Giuliani out falsely disparaging Michael Cohen? Because they fear him. What do they fear, Chris? Why am I representing him? They fear that he has the truth about Donald Trump. He will someday speak the truth about Donald Trump. The truth is that when Donald Trump said cash, which Rudy Giuliani knows that only drug dealers and mobsters talk about cash. It was, you heard Michael Cohen say what? No.
And you're saying he wasn't saying, no, I would never pay with cash. I'll only pay with a check.
He was saying, no, you don't pay with cash. And that is why what you heard, no matter what the spin, is about truth versus falsehood. And this is what this whole thing is about. It's not gotcha. Mr. Trump used the word cash, and he lied about it by having Giuliani accuse Cohen saying the word cash. Now we've put the tape out, and you decide whether I'm telling you the truth because the tape says what it says. But this is about the big topic in America today, a president of the United States who consistently lies. Now he has Giuliani lying about the lie. Remember, they lied about what he said on Air Force One, openly lied. He said, no, I had nothing to do with Stormy Daniels. Then Giuliani said, oh, yes, he did. Then he lied about the statement in Trump Tower that he knew had nothing to do with it. It wasn't misleading. He, in fact, was involved in the writing of a definitely misleading statement. This is a repeated pattern that now Giuliani is a participant in. He's not here tonight because I would say, Mayor Giuliani, when you were U.S. attorney and people paid with cash, what kind of people choose cash? But, and he would say drug dealers and mobsters.
No, he would say something else because he said it to me. He would say nobody paid anything. This was never transacted. The corporation that Cohen is talking about, we believe, was set up as an entity, but never paid any money to anybody.
And I don't dispute, one of the few things I don't dispute when Mr. Giuliani talks about an irrelevancy to get away from the issue of truth. He accused falsely, Michael Cohen of using the word cash. All America and all the media now knows that was a lie, and the tape says very clearly, Mr. Trump used the word cash. So this is about truth, and the larger issue we face in coming months will be about truth versus falsehood.
Wait, I want to ask you about a couple of things. The first thing is, the tape, people are going to hear it. They're going to say, man, it cuts off fast at the end and goes to another conversation. Why?
I don't know. Mr. Cohen has no explanation. The phone either cut off or stopped recording, so we don't know why it suddenly got clipped off, but we do know that Donald Trump uses the word cash.
And then check.
At the very, very end, after Donald hears, excuse me, after Mr. Trump hears Mr. Cohen say, no, 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 then we hear Mr. Trump say, check. After,
all right.
After Mr. Cohen says, no, 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 but Mr. Giuliani said it was my client, Michael Cohen, who used the word cash. That was false.
In speaking with Rudy Giuliani today, he does not make the case, at least to me, that Cohen said he wanted to pay with cash and Trump said, no, use a check. He says that his point is that the president wanted Cohen to pay by check, not cash, because he wanted this dealt with on the up and up.
So I would say walking back, but I have to
And by the way, we have statements like that from the... Sorry about putting my hand in front of your face. Put up for the audience some of Giuliani's statements, which echo what I'm telling people that he told me today as well. When you find them, put them up, all right? Cohen is talking about buying the rights from AMI. True. They're talking about a corporation doing it. True. One of their corporations doing it. Continue. President says, make sure it's done correctly. Make sure it's done by check.
I don't know where Giuliani's getting his words, but I can tell you what everybody in America heard. The false accusation against Michael Cohen is that he used the word cash. The tape says false. The tape is the truth. Then Rudy Giuliani says he didn't know about Karen McDougal until this meeting. We know, listen to the tape, Donald Trump is not shocked that money is being paid concerning someone named Karen McDougal. And finally, we know that Trump has lied, even during the campaign, when his campaign spokesman denied 2 months after this tape that he knew anything about Karen McDougal. Ladies and gentlemen, if you voted for Donald Trump, listen to the tape and ask yourself, is Donald Trump lying when he said he didn't use the word cash and accuses Michael Cohen of using the word cash? Cohen has been disparaged. Cohen has been insulted and called all sorts of things by people around Donald Trump. And the question is, why are they attacking him? Why am I representing him? Because he's got truth on his side, and he will continue to tell the truth.
Although, look, in fairness, to take a step away from the tape, Michael Cohen is not the most sympathetic character for people when it comes to Donald Trump. He was a heavy for Trump. I worked Michael Cohen all through the campaign to get him on. He would come on. We'd go back and forth about his arguments. He was a relentless defender for Trump. He was constantly saying he'd do anything for him. Now he's saying, well, I needed to protect myself from what I was doing for then Donald J. Trump, not president. So I recorded him to protect myself. That's why he did it. Is that going to fall on sympathetic ears for people? You did all these things for Trump. And then at the same time, you were recording him because you wanted to protect yourself. Why didn't you just not do those things?
So I'm going to do something in a very sober, I've smiled a bit and laughed at Mr. Giuliani because it's laughable that he's trying to twist what's on the tape. You can't do that. But let me be very serious with you about Michael Cohen. It took me a while to decide to represent him. It took me a while after he spoke to Mr. Stephanopoulos on the air to see that his positions are diametrically opposite from Mr. Trump. He was diametrically opposite in telling Mr. Stephanopoulos he believes in the FBI and respects it, opposite from Trump. He thinks the Trump Tower meeting was dumb, opposite from Trump. He agrees with the intelligence community's assessment that Russia meddled in our election, opposite from Donald Trump. This man has come to a moment in his life. And I won't talk about what he did in the past for Donald Trump other than being a loyal defender as an attorney. But I will tell you my own personal view. This man has turned a corner in his life, has hit a reset button, and he's now dedicated to telling the truth. And the reason why Giuliani is attacking him so viciously, rewriting what everybody hears with their own plain ears, is they're afraid of him because Donald Trump can't stand the truth, to quote a famous movie, and the truth will come out, Chris.
The counter is that what they hate is that the attorney taped the client and that they're now worried that to save his skin with federal prosecutors, he'll tell them whatever they want to hear and that he can't be trusted because he'd make something like this in the first place.
Well, you can see why Mr. Trump would be worried when he denies saying the word cash when everyone in America now knows that he lied.
But you won't give him the benefit of context on cash the way Giuliani is saying.
I don't care what they say, words like context, walking back, I should have used the word not. These are people that scramble the truth up when they're caught. He's caught. The word is cash. They denied using the word cash, and they put it into my client's mouth. They're caught. Now, it's context. It's transcripts. They're not hearing right. Now they're going to say the tape was made up. It's all fake news. I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, what is not fake? Your own ears and your common sense. No matter what I say, don't believe me. Listen to the tape and ask yourself, is it right for a president of the United States, before he's elected, to use the word cash, which drug dealers and mobsters will prefer, so there's no tracking, which a check is, and you hear Michael say, no, 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 no. That's truth. And going forward, Chris, I'm predicting to you, they are afraid of Michael Cohen. They're certainly aware of my political background that I'm representing Michael Cohen. And I'm telling you, we have truth on our side, and whatever Mr. Cohen regrets in the past will be up to him to say to you. But I am telling you, we have truth and they are afraid, which is why Rudy Giuliani is not here tonight, but making things up in a transcript regarding a tape that he has invented in his own mind without confronting what the tape says.
But point of fairness to Rudy Giuliani, he spent a lot of time with me on the phone going over the transcript.
But not with me here on the set.
But he may take it. It was last second.
Come on, Rudy.
Lanny, as you know.
I invite him back to take me on directly.
I understand. I just believe that all this stuff, there's no reason to be partial about any of this. People can hear it for themselves. They can think
Absolutely.
About it. It's not the best recording. That's why it's going to take some dispute of analysis. The corporation, just to make sure I'm right about something.
Right.
I believe, from my reporting, that corporation was in fact formed. Is that true?
I'm trying to decide whether I can answer any of your questions that I got from my client.
And if that is true,
privilege. So I probably can't
answer
your question. I'll
skip past. If I am right about that, was this corporation set up for anybody else other than McDougal?
Again, this is information I obtained from a client. I'm not allowed to answer your question, but I will answer this, which is what you're looking for. Donald Trump was told about that corporation on tape, and you heard it. Mm-hmm. Was he shocked? Did he say, what's that about? Who's Karen McDougal? Oh, my God, why are we talking about paying check or cash?
Right.
No, he knew exactly. Listen to the tape. When he says he knew nothing about Karen McDougal before this meeting, ask yourself, is that on the tape? And when he denied knowing anything about Karen McDougal before the campaign was done by his press spokesman,
right.
Ask yourself, was Donald Trump lying or not? And the big issue going forward is going to be about, we all know his lies, but you can't deny a tape. Richard Nixon said 1 year of Watergate is enough. 1 year later, a tape caused him to resign from the presidency.
The reason I'm asking you is that when Cohen is talking to Trump about it, and he's talking about his friend David Pecker, doesn't sound like they're talking about just one thing. And I believe if people listen to it closely, they're going to hear him say those things that we were talking about that he has. And it seems like there was a collection of things that they wanted back from David Pecker. That's why I'm asking you. I know you won't answer, but I want that to be in people's minds, well, that may not have been just about Karen McDougal.
Let me try to answer that. Michael Cohen is an authentic, sincere man, hurting because the power of the presidency, Rudy Giuliani and all the henchmen are now after Michael Cohen. And he's living in a hotel because his apartment was drenched, and he's forced to live in a hotel with a family that's being attacked by a president. And the end result here is what they were talking about was paying money in order to keep something quiet. Mm-hmm. And that's what Donald Trump has been up to for a long time and lying about many subjects. And this is the one time, which is why I seem to be smiling so much, because it's a serious moment, where there's no disputing the sound that you hear with your own ears. And I invite everybody, listen to this tape, and you decide.
Lanny Davis, thank you for making the tape available. Appreciate you going through the arguments on both sides with
us. Thank you, Chris.
All right. So what is this tape going to mean? You've got two categories. You have political and legal implications. We're going to test them all for you tonight. You're going to hear that tape again. This is a special Cuomo's Court that we're going to have for you with some top lawyers who have made and defended these kinds of cases. Next. All right, back now with more on this coveted surrounding a payment to a former playmate named Karen McDougal. I want to play for you the relevant section. You got to listen closely. This wasn't a well-made tape, but there's plenty to find out in it.
And I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with funding. And it's all the stuff. All the stuff. Because, you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay with cash.
No. I got... No.
All right. Are there potential legal issues with what you just heard? Let's bring in Cuomo's Court now in session. Ken Cuccinelli, Alan Dershowitz, and Laura Coates. It's good to have all three of you. Laura Coates, I start with you. Your interest in this.
Well, you know, what you're seeing here is that Michael Cohen is very well aware that the gloves need to come off. It's a credibility campaign going on right now. And in a game of he said, he wants to prevail. Particularly, although it seems to people that the idea of whether he said cash or did he say check may seem like a very nominal matter, what he's trying to establish is that there was some awareness on behalf of Donald Trump at the time that there was this pending transaction, this agreement with Karen McDougal, and that he himself was trying to at least appeal to his good senses in some way, talking about no. And so I think you're seeing this all play out in real time, but certainly the gloves are off. And if you're Donald Trump, you're concerned that there may be additional information that his tape alluded to in the form of all the things in case David Pecker no longer is in charge of AMI.
Now, Alan Dershowitz, Professor, even if we take the reckoning of the recording as Lanny Davis, counsel to Michael Cohen, wants us to take it, which is, it wasn't Michael Cohen suggesting paying cash, it was Donald Trump. And Michael Cohen said, no, don't pay cash. And then Donald Trump said, fine, use a check. Relevance.
Well, first of all, I don't know why anybody waived the lawyer-client communication regarding this tape.
Gosh, yeah.
Here you have a lawyer and a client discussing something. The client
Rudy Giuliani
saying,
says it's because they think
cash.
It helps them.
Well, here you have the client maybe saying, let's pay cash. The lawyer says, no, do it by check. And the client comes back and says, I'll do it by check. That's a typical conversation. I've had that conversation a dozen times with clients. And you persuade them to do the right thing. But I think the big picture here is, number one, Lanny is a terrific lawyer. And so there is a real lawyer who is now against Trump, unlike Avenatti and some of the others, a really, really good lawyer who's on this case. Second of all, you have a situation where, you know, he's going to flip. There's no question. He's now made it clear.
Flip on what? He hasn't even been charged.
And so I know, but he's going to flip. He said he's going to tell the truth. He's going to cooperate. He's turned. He's pressed the reset button. If that doesn't mean that he's going to cooperate with the government, I don't know how you could say it any more than if you walked into the prosecutor's office and said, ask me any question you want me to ask.
But he says he has been cooperating.
But what?
Hold on. Let me get to Ken in here. Let me get in here. I got three great minds. I want to use them all. Ken, let's assume that now Rudy Giuliani is right. And he is saying that the transcript will show, once you sweeten the audio and have a forensicist look at it and extract the true words, you will hear the president say, with an admonishing tone, do not pay cash. Use a check. Does that matter to you?
Well, sure, it matters along the lines that Laura was describing. Each piece of the puzzle actually reflects on all the other pieces. I do have the same first reaction that Alan Dershowitz had, is it's just mind-blowing to me to be hearing a tape of an attorney-client conversation. I mean, I don't know why any client or their lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, would ever think it's a good idea to start releasing these things.
Well, he says he didn't release it.
It helps their side.
He didn't release it. He says that the president waived the privilege because they believe the tape is not hurtful, it's helpful, and they want prosecutors to have it.
Well, and we all hear slightly different things on that tape. You could say cash is a question instead of a statement, and then he says check is it's being cut off. But part of the problem we're getting is you do have a good lawyer here in Lanny Davis who's presented a part of a piece of evidence. And I say a part of a piece of evidence because we don't know what other recordings are out there, and we really don't know the surrounding context when you take such a slice like this. So. It is a little difficult to work with.
Well, let's chew on the suggestion. Laura
but
Coates,
the big Lanny, picture.
Lanny Davis, hold on a second, Professor.
The Lanny big
One second. Lanny Davis says that it's relevant for two reasons. One, it shows that the president was familiar with Karen McDougal being paid and the efforts of his attorney to buy back assets, plural, which is something I've never really thought about before. I thought it was just about McDougal, but now it seems this corporation was formed to buy back assets. Things, plural, from David Pecker. I don't know what else they thought he had. But that's what it shows, number one. And that, two, to say Michael Cohen wanted to pay cash and that Trump said, no, do it the right way, is not what the tape reveals. Your take on those two points?
Yeah, well, he's accurate on the first point, that it seems from my version and reading of the actual tape, it actually says to me that he is alluding to trying to have an overall umbrella in case there's something that happens with the company or the stories go someplace else or David Pecker is hit by a bus. He talks about all these different things. Remember, he's the head of a magazine and a number of magazines that allegedly has been able to protect the president of the United States as citizen and now as president from damaging stories that are against his actual interests. That could be true in the number one. The second part of it is the idea of why it's so important, this cash versus check distinction. People are hearing the words corporation, Chris, and they're thinking about essential consultants and Stormy Daniels. Mm-hmm. But he's talking about AMI and about buying back stories, and he's trying to lay the foundation right now that you have to trust this person, Michael Cohen, as opposed to somebody who was a seedy, nefarious character who simply was trying to hide the ball for federal election purposes or other things. He's trying to plant a seed in America's mind that this person was simply acting at the discretion and at the pleasure of the president as his attorney, which, again, is why it's mind-boggling he would have released this tape. But it does serve, in many ways, Rudy Giuliani to say, hey, there is different ways to hear this, and you now, by having that seed of doubt, now his credibility is in question yet again.
All right, President,
but
not yet.
Remember,
Professor, weigh in on this. What do you think? Go ahead, make your point, please.
This is all political.
Right.
There is no crime here. The worst case scenario, take everything Lanny Davis says is true. There's no crime. There's no federal crime. There's no impeachable offense. This is all about how the president looks in the court of public opinion, whether or not he, through his lawyer, said something that was not true. I think they will win that fight because the tape's ambiguous enough so that there will be people who will hear it the way they want to hear it and other people who will hear it the way they want to hear it. But there's nothing criminal here. And I'm still going back to the first question. Why waive this lawyer? This is a classic lawyer-client communication. It's not within the fraud privilege. It's an honest conversation, and it ends up with the president doing exactly the right thing in the sense of paying by check rather than paying by cash. So why do you waive
that's not
this?
Even the
why
case.
Do you have it out there?
That's not even the case, Professor.
And it wasn't
I'll
even
take
done.
Your point.
Yeah.
There was no transaction. There is no proof that ever exchanged hands. There is proof
right.
that the corporation was set up for that purpose, but there is no transaction. Yeah.
There's no crime.
So Ken Cuccinelli, there's no crime to the professor's reckoning on this. Is there exposure? Is there concern?
It's as the professor said, this is it's public appearance concern for sure. It's truth or falsity concern once again. But I think, Chris, we've talked about in the past, these things don't seem to matter to voters. When you boil it down to policy and politics, they don't seem to matter to voters. And if there isn't an illegal act here, and it doesn't sound to me, nothing on this tape suggests to me there's an illegal act, then it is about favorable and unfavorable ratings.
Well,
that's what it's
about. I'll take you on that. We're going to lose the professor, so let me say goodbye to all three of you. Laura, I got to go because I'm going to lose.
Okay.
Professor. You've all made great points. Thank you very much. Ken Cuccinelli, Alan Dershowitz,
good to be with you, Chris.
And Laura Coates. Thanks to all three of them. I will say this, though, to Ken's last point. The truth is a side, okay? I'm playing this straight and fair for you to hear what you hear and let you know what both sides are disputing about it. But the truth is a side. Whether or not you care about the politics, whether or not Trump is your guy or not your guy is irrelevant. The truth is aside. The truth matters. We need to know who's telling us the truth in power. And that's why we're bringing you this recording. So that's the court of law and three good minds on it. But as they were showing you, the court of public opinion is where most of this is likely to play out. So who wins on this tape? We'll take it up in our great debate next. By now, we have a primetime exclusive, one of the secret recordings of President Trump, taped by his former longtime lawyer, Michael Cohen. In the audio, you can hear Trump back in 2016 discussing arrangements surrounding a payment to a former Playboy playmate named Karen McDougal. That payment was made by a third party. So here is the relevant part of the audio that is the subject of much dispute between the two sides.
And I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with funding. And it's all the stuff. Because, you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
So there's a big dispute about is the president or then citizen Donald Trump telling his lawyer pay cash, and Cohen is saying no, and then Trump says pay with a check, or what the president Trump legal team says is that he said don't pay by cash and pay by check. Now this is all happening in real time, and Alan Futterfuss, who's a lawyer with the Trump Organization, sent a response. Who's ever telling Davis, Lanny Davis, counsel to Michael Cohen, who gave us the recording, that cash in the conversation refers to green currency, is lying to him. There's no transaction done in currency. It doesn't happen. The whole deal never happened. That's true. There was no transaction to our knowledge. It never happened, this payment of buying things back from the National Enquirer, their parent company. If it was going to happen, it would be a payment to a large company that would obviously be accompanied by an agreement of sale. Maybe, maybe not. Those documents would be prepared by lawyers on both sides. Same concern. The suggestion that the cash in the conversation refers to green currency is false. All right, listen to this. Not just ridiculous, it's false. The word cash came up in the context of the distinction between financing, which is referenced, and no financing, which means a full payment, a total one-time payment. That's the context in which the word cash is used. Anyone who knows anything about the company or how the president does business knows there is no green cash. Everything is documented. Every penny is documented. We'd know a lot more about that if we'd seen the president's taxes. But what they're saying is, the Trump org is saying, cash was like a term of art. Meaning, are we going to finance over time or give a one-time payment? The president wasn't talking about paying with cash to make it harder to track such a transaction. What do you think? That's up to you. Now let's bring in the great debaters, Angela Rye and David Urban. Angela, when I say cash, I don't mean green money. I mean a method of financing. And this is proof of the president wanting to do it the right way, even if his lawyer had other ideas. Do you accept that reckoning of the tape?
Chris, I said would, not would not. I can't with these folks. Like, it is an ongoing cast of shady characters, of which Michael Cohen has just been summarily dismissed. I have problems as an attorney. I have problems with the fact that he's recorded a conversation. I have problems with the fact that there's even some discussion about how to set up some type of corporation to pay for a story that exists with Donald Trump's friends. I was reading earlier about AMI and National Enquirer and the fact that one of their very senior editors said that there wasn't a single story published in the National Enquirer that they didn't get Donald Trump's approval for when it was about him. That is the problem. The focus on cash versus check, I can tell you myself, I heard you say this in the last segment. I heard Donald Trump say check at the end. I did hear that. I'm not going to lie. I don't have to lie to Kick It Craig. You know why? Because Donald Trump lies enough for himself every single day. I'm not calling you Craig. It's a line from a movie, Chris. I just like I'll go up. However, okay, you're hip. But however, I think the most important thing that we have here is there is a playmate named Kieran McDougal who he denied having any interaction with, any sexual relationship with. We've heard this before. It was right. from a Democratic president. His name was Bill Clinton. I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
All right, but this is a little bit of a different scenario. And the point of the tape, Dave, from Lanny Davis, counsel for Michael Cohen's perspective, is the idea that the president, then private citizen Donald Trump, didn't know anything about the arrangements surrounding the payment to McDougal, which we've been told, at least by Hope Hicks, and what we heard on Air Force One, is not true, that he was familiar with the arrangement. And the second one is the idea that it was Cohen pushing a cash payment is not true, it was Trump.
So Chris, look, I agree with Angela as well as with the august legal panel you had on before this. Michael Cohen's taping of his client, his surreptitious taping of his client, is not illegal, but it's clearly unethical. And if Lanny Davis thinks that somehow this is exculpatory and it shows that Michael Cohen is somehow the victim here, I think it's going to backfire on him.
Well, it's about truth. Who do you think is telling the truth?
Well, Chris, look, this is, and as was said earlier in the earlier segment, truth is Aristotelian. There's no Aristotelian truth in this sense, right? This is going to be a Rorschach test. This recording, as somebody said earlier, Trump detractors are going to hear what they want to hear. Trump supporters are going to hear what they want to hear. You'll have a bunch of forensic audiologists juice this tape, you know, cut it, you know, play it 1,000 different ways, and you're going to hear what you want to hear in the tape. And you know, to your point,
but at the end of the day, Dave, do you believe that the president was aware that his lawyer was setting up a corporation to buy a bunch of assets from the parent company of the Inquirer?
So Chris, you know, I listened to this tape for the first time about 15 minutes ago on this show. It's pretty garbled. I've tried to, you know, follow the bouncing ball through this all. You know, I can't tell you what I believe at this point because I can't hear it. I can't, you know, intelligibly hear what's being said.
Let's listen
said
to it again
tape.
To help
yeah.
Dave.
Yeah, you can play it slow.
I'll just play it how it happened.
Okay.
Yeah. I need to open up a company for the transfer of all of that info regarding our friend David, you know, so that I'm going to do that right away. I've actually come up and I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with funding. And it's all the stuff. All the stuff, because you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay with cash.
No. I got...
Now that you've heard it, Dave, do you believe the president was familiar with what Cohen was talking about, or do you think this was a first impression?
No, I don't think this is the first discussion that was had on the topic. I do...
Well, that's
a
problem, isn't it?
You kind of made your point there about the financing part. I just heard it again where Michael Cohen talks about financing, and the president says, "What financing? We need to, you know, we're not going to finance this." So, look, it's all about intent. It's about what the party's intended here. You don't know. It's a piece of the puzzle, as former AG Cuccinelli said. This is a snapshot of one conversation had at one time, taken out of context.
All right.
And listen, Chris. Even if you assume that all these things are true in this tape, in this tape, nothing. There was nothing done that was illegal. You said there was no payment made.
I don't think it's about a crime.
There was no payment made. There's no peaceable offense.
I don't think we can allow that as a bar for behavior in our society, felonies and below are okay.
No,
I just think
felonies
people
below.
Can
this
hear
even a misdemeanor.
It, and they're going to make
even a
judgments.
Misdemeanor.
Right.
It's not a speeding ticket.
I'm saying I don't think that criminal conduct is the bar for responsible behavior.
It didn't even occur, Chris.
Say.
It didn't occur.
Well, there was no transaction done. There was no transaction
so
affected.
So there's a discussion about something that may or may not have happened.
But I got to go.
No, listen, wait, no, hear me out. There's a discussion about something that may or may not have happened.
No, there's a discussion about something that certainly happened. There was not a cash transaction for the assets for various reasons.
So a discussion about something that may...
Right, but it's just about who's telling the truth about the situation, who isn't. Last point, Angela, then I got to go.
There are also crimes that exist based on the planning of doing and committing a worse offense.
Of course there are. Of course.
Yeah. So let's be clear that discussions are also damning, too. So this is a damning discussion.
But nothing occurred. Even Chris admits it. Nothing occurred.
But
he knows... Something did occur. He had sex and a relationship with this woman, and they were planning off how to pay her for the story and her silence.
You don't know that from this conversation.
Whether the payment happened or not, what we know is that he lied.
Let's leave it there.
Every day.
I think there are credibility issues. We'll see what people decide about it. You don't have to commit a crime to be judged in terms of the content of your behavior as a leader. That's all I'm saying. Dave, I know you agree with that. Angela, thank you very much. Appreciate both. Angela Rye, David Urban. So there are lots of questions, and there are not going to be as many answers, all right? This tape is going to continue to play out. Other tapes may well come out. There is a competition between the president and his former lawyer. Some final thoughts and takeaways, the right questions to be asking. Next. All right, here's our closing argument about this. Now, this has become quite a protracted situation. I'm reading all the reactions that you guys are having online to this. You don't have to examine it through the lens of whether or not this is a crime. I don't even think that's helpful. This tape is about intentionality and credibility. Here is the salient part of the conversation.
I need to open up a company for the transfer of all of that info regarding our friend David, you know, so that I'm going to do that right away. I've actually come up and I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with funding. And it's all the stuff, because, you know, you never know where that company,
you never know where he's going to be.
Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be...
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay with cash.
No.
Is what you hear proof the president knew about the deal to pay for Karen McDougal's story? Or does it sound like new information to the president? Then there's the question of how to pay.
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay with cash.
No.
I'll just bring him in now. Bring in Don Lemon now. Come on in. Don Lemon's going to pick up this story right now. This is going to be a big situation for him. So as soon as Don is ready.